the idea behind wearing homemade masks, and we've seen a lot about this in the news, is that the CDC recently came out and recommended that everybody should be wearing a mask as much as possible when they're out and about in public. And the reason for that is because as we've gone forward with this virus, what we've found is that it's possible that people could be potentially contagious while they don't have symptoms. Either they haven't gotten sick yet, or some people never do have a lot of symptoms, and yet they could be potentially contagious to other people even while they feel fine. So the idea with wearing homemade masks is to provide an extra barrier, an extra layer of protection for people in the community. And actually, the mask is primarily for others. It's something you are doing for other people to protect them from you, in case you potentially might be contagious and just not know it yet. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, and I may get a fever and a cough tomorrow, and I could be potentially contagious right now and not know it, and I don't want to get you sick. So these masks, these homemade masks, function very well to make sure that people are not breathing virus or coughing virus into the community or onto surfaces out and about, like at the grocery store and that sort of thing. So that's why CDC has come out with this recommendation. I think we're seeing in the hospital at Mary Greeley and throughout McFarland that we'll be using these masks while we're at work and in the community to just continue to provide leadership from the medical standpoint. And that's why I'm wearing one. So, you know, there's all sorts of things you can do with fabric and, you know, the different ties and, you know, loops versus ribbons, and we've got a huge network of volunteers that are helping us right now make these, and we really want to thank them, really appreciate all their work. There are designs that are available on both the Mary Greeley and the McFarland websites to help guide the community about what types of masks we're hoping to use. And I really do think over time what we'll find is we'll find some best practices about masks, and we may find that that they actually provide really good protection, even the other direction, from breathing things in, but we're still waiting for studies to help guide us on that. So in general, wearing a mask is important because it's really moving towards our efforts of just continuing to bend that curve down and prevent more infections. I think there's been a lot of interest here in the community about what's going on with coronavirus in our community. And I would say, for right now, we are not seeing a lot of coronavirus spread in Story County or even in the surrounding counties as part of the McFarland network. You can see that data on the Iowa Department of Public Health website. You can see, for example, Story County has 6 cases as of this morning. And you know, we've done hundreds and hundreds of tests here through our network looking for people that could potentially be infected. And you know, the grand majority of those have come back negative. I think that is happening. I think we are doing really well here in our county because people are making such a strong effort to continue the social distancing practices, continue those hygiene practices of washing hands, and continuing to stay home if they're sick. Those things are making a difference in our community. I think it's really important people try to continue those as much as possible. It may be because we are in a more rural area that our peak could be later. And so even if things are flattening out in New York or even flattening out in, you know, the urban areas of Iowa, we will want to stay vigilant here to make sure we don't see any sort of late peak. We have had cases that we've seen through our respiratory virus clinic that we've got set up in North Ames and also in locations in Marshalltown and Carroll. Those patients are approached with great care, and they get their swab generally in their car, both for their protection and for the protection of healthcare workers. There's been a lot of information about shortages of health worker gear, and that's something that we've been paying attention to for months in terms of preparing and doing everything we can to have the gear available that we need. And that's one of the reasons from the outpatient side that we've tried to have patients go to a central location like these respiratory clinics so that we can help save or conserve that limited amount of gear that we have. The hospital is taking a similar approach. We've had patients that do have coronavirus at Mary Greeley, and we've got mechanisms in place to help protect workers, healthcare workers on the front lines, both with protective gear and locating patients together and in similar places, and also protect other patients that are in the hospital that don't have coronavirus. So far, I think we're doing pretty well, considering. There's not very many cases in our county or in our area. The people that I've had the opportunity to take care of have done very well. It seems like it's about a two-week illness, that people are sick for a while, at least the people that have ended up in the hospital. Right now, we are using some of the treatments that have been brought up in the media. So, for example, there's been interest in this anti-malaria medicine, hydroxychloroquine. We have been using that when people are in the hospital. We just have to do it with care because there are potential side effects. So that's one thing that we're doing. For people that don't require time in the hospital, we're generally trying to avoid using that medication because of the potential side effects. So it's available. We have some supply, and we're trying to use that supply if people seem like they're sick enough to be in the hospital. Otherwise, there's not a specific treatment that's what I'd call well-studied right now. Everything is a little bit anecdotal. You know, it seems like this is working in Michigan, this is working in New York, this is working in LA. And we're trying to sift through that day by day to say, is there clues about what might work best? So I think we have a protocol right now if people do end up needing to come into the hospital. There are tests being developed that can tell us if somebody has had this infection in the past or not. So those are called antibody tests. And there may have been some reports in the news that people have read. Those are all very new. And just like any test that gets developed in America, there's a pretty strict, rigorous approach to make sure that test is good and reliable. And so as those tests become available, and we feel here that they're reliable, I think we'll start using them and make that available to people to be tested to find out, was that fever and cough that they had 3 weeks ago, but they were able to stay home, did they actually have this virus? I think we'll be able to figure that out eventually. We're just not there yet. So hopefully over time we'll have antibody tests available. I think in general with most viruses like this, if somebody's had it, they're probably protected from getting that infection again. Every virus is a little bit different, and how long that protection lasts is uncertain. But based on what we know about other viruses, having the virus and mounting an immune response against it and getting better sort of implies that somebody will probably be protected from getting that virus again in the future. In fact, there's even been studies going on of having people that have recovered from this infection then go forward and actually donate blood, and their immune response can then actually be given to a patient that's acutely ill. And so that's something that we're looking into here within our healthcare network as well. Both the clinic and the hospital have really realigned their resources to be ready. And that includes changes in staffing, of training people in different areas of the hospital to have new skills. It includes delaying non-essential surgeries to create capacity and increase room availability. It includes retraining of staff on how to use different equipment and making respirators available. So we're fortunate right now, as we have looked at some of these projections from the University of Washington, it looks to me like Iowa right now has enough resources to handle the expected peak. Right now we're projected to peak in about 2 weeks. And it looks to me like at the time of that peak, they anticipate, based on their modeling, that we'll have enough hospital beds, we'll have enough intensive care units, beds, and enough ventilators if needed. And we're learning a lot every day from other parts of the country and the world about how this virus goes. And that's been incredibly helpful to us in terms of our preparations.